friends, and welcome back to another broadcast. This is the day that the Lord has made, and I will rejoice and be glad in it. We're so glad that you decided to join us today for today's message. Today we are dealing with the subject, God has set an appointed time. Yes, my friends, God has set an appointed time. We're going to get ready to go to the sanctuary. But before we do so, let us lend the ear to today's special music.
We don't need another political uprising. No, no, no. We don't need another comet on the sea. But what we need is a special word that will burn within our hearts and give us direction. We're from y'all, from above. We need a word from the Lord. A word from the Lord. Just one word from the Lord, and it will move on. Want to hear from Jesus? Oh yeah, listen, listen.
Lord, we lack your wisdom and understanding. Oh, we lack the very love you've shown in the Son. And yes, we've halted in all of our ways, and Lord, we stand so much to gain. So give us your word, Lord. Speak, Lord. We need a word from the Lord. A word from the Lord. Just one word from the Lord. Shall we remove all the doubt and call the sun to shine?
Spoke to me, and I brought it to you tonight. Listen, listen. I was in Nashville, Tennessee, sitting there preparing to do what I'm doing right now, but I was so depressed about things that have happened in my past. Bishop Kenneth Mole stood on his feet and he sang these words to me, and they came straight from the Lord, and I brought them to you to let you know this is what the Lord said. He told me to tell you that your ladder will be great. Greater than your
Heavenly Father, and speak to our hearts as we open up your word. Pray, O God, that heaven would come down and glory would fill our souls as we worship you. As we look to your word, O God, we ask that you would look into our lives and those things that are not pleasing in your sight, remove them from us. Forgive us of our sins, our shortcomings, we pray, and speak now. In Jesus' name, amen. You have your Bibles, I invite you to turn with me to the book of Exodus. Exodus chapter 9. And I shall read in your hearing verses 1 through 5. That's Exodus chapter 9. And I shall read in your hearing verses 1 through 5. The Bible says, "Then the Lord said unto Moses, Go in unto Pharaoh and tell him, Thus says the Lord God of the Hebrews, Let my people go, that they may serve me. For if thou refuse to let them go and will hold them still, behold, the hand of the Lord is upon thy cattle which is in the field, upon the horses, upon the asses, upon the camels, upon the oxen, and upon the sheep. There shall be a very grievous murrain. And the Lord shall sever between the cattle of Israel and the cattle of Egypt, and there shall nothing die of all that is of the children of Israel. And the Lord appointed a set time, saying, Tomorrow the Lord shall do this thing in the land." The word of God for the people of God. I want to talk to you today on the subject, the Lord has appointed a set time. The Lord has appointed a set time. In this chapter, God was in the process of delivering Israel from Egyptian bondage. He had not delivered them yet, but was in the process. They had been in bondage for quite some time and no doubt had prayed for deliverance. He had heard their cry and had the ability to deliver them in an instance, but he chose not to. He chose to deliver them through a process. He was in the process of delivering them. Let me just pause here to interject and say to the one who has been praying for an instant deliverance, let me say to you that God does not always deliver in an instance. But if you have been praying to him, he has heard your prayer and he is in the process of delivering you. The plagues of Egypt began in chapter 7. By the time we get to Exodus chapter 9, God had already turned their rivers and streams into blood. He had already sent the frogs from the river, streams, and ponds to invade the land. He had plagued them with lice. He had sent the swarm of flies, and yet Pharaoh had not let his people go. Here in chapter 9, verses 1 through 4, God promises that his hand would be upon the Egyptian cattle, upon their horses, their asses, their camels, their oxen, their sheep. God promised in verse 4 that he would make a distinction between the cattle of Israel and the cattle of Egypt, and that nothing of the children of Israel would die. I'm glad to know that God makes a distinction between those that are his and those that are not. I'm glad to know that God is able to plague those that are not his and at the same time protect and prosper those who are his. You might be wondering why your old automobile is
still running and your neighbor's newer automobile stays in the shop, it's because God has made a distinction between you and your neighbor, and he is blessing your stuff while their stuff is falling apart. In relaying this message to Pharaoh, Moses tells him in verse 5 that the Lord had appointed a set time in which he would do this thing. I want you to understand, saints, that whatever God does, he does it in his own time frame. He does it at the time that he has set up. I want to say that again. Whatever God does, he does it in his own time frame. The Bible tells us in Ecclesiastes 3, verses 1 and 2, it says, to everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up that which is planted. God has scheduled the affairs and activities of earth according to his divine clock, not according to our time schedule, but according to his. In Genesis chapter 17, verse 21, God told Abraham that Sarah would bear Isaac at the set time the following year. We are familiar with the story. We know that Sarah was old and stricken in years, and she had not had a child. But God told Abraham in Genesis 17, 21, that she would have it at the set time the following year. And then in Genesis 21 and verse 2, the Bible says, for Sarah conceived and bare Abraham a son in his old age at the set time, at the what? At the set time of which God has spoken to him. God does everything according to his set time. In 2 Kings chapter 6, there was a severe famine, and I don't have time to go to all of these scriptures that I'm going to give you, but I want to encourage you to read the chapter, read the scriptures that I give you. In 2 Kings chapter 6, there was a severe famine in the land of Samaria. The city had been shut up because the Assyrians had surrounded the city. No one was able to get in and no one was able to go out. And therefore, after a period of time, because the people could not go and get food, they began to suffer starvation. The people were on the brink of starvation. And just when they had given up hope, the Lord sends a word through his prophet Elisha in 2 Kings 7 and 1. And he says, hear ye the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord, tomorrow about this time shall a measure of fine flour be sold for a shekel and 2 measures of barley for a shekel in the gate of Samaria. In other words, God has set the time, and he said, tomorrow. You might be starving today, but tomorrow food is going to be cheap. Tomorrow food is going to be plentiful. And God has set it up according to his set time. And if you read 2 Kings chapter 7, you will discover that it happened just as God said. The next day food was plentiful. God does nothing before after the appointed time. It is important to note here in Exodus 9 that it was not Moses who appointed the set time. Notice very closely, it was not Moses, it was not Aaron who appointed the set time, it was not Pharaoh who appointed the set time. The set time, or the time, was appointed and set by God. In Exodus chapter 9, verses 1 through 4, God relays what he's going to do. In verse 5, God tells when he's going to do it. I want you to understand that God can tell you what he's going to do, when he's going to do it, how he's going to do it, and then turn around and do it when he said, how he said, and where he said it. God said in verse 5 that he was going to do this thing on tomorrow or on the next day. And if we look at verse 6, we will discover that God performed what he had promised. Exodus 9 and verse 6 says this, and the Lord did that thing on the morrow. And all the cattle of Egypt died, but the cattle of the children of Israel died not. In other words, they didn't die. And in Exodus 9 and verse 18, God promised to send hail upon Egypt at a set time. He said, behold, tomorrow about this time, I will cause it to rain a very grievous hail, such as has not been in Egypt since the foundation thereof, even until now. And then in Exodus 9, verse 24 and 26, you see the fulfillment of what God said he was going to do. The Bible says in Exodus 9, verse 24, so there was hail and fire mingled with the hail, very grievous, such as there was none like it in all the land of Egypt since it became a nation. Verse 25 says, and the hail smote throughout all the land of Egypt, all that was in the field, both man and beast. And the hail smote every herb in the field and break every tree of the field. Verse 26 says, only in the land of Goshen, where the children of Israel were, was there no hail. We can be encouraged today, my brothers. We can be encouraged today, my sisters, knowing that what God has promised, he will perform, but he will perform it at his set time. Don't want you to miss that. I don't want you to miss that, because a lot of times we try to put God on our time schedule, and God will come through, but he's going to come through when he wants to, where he wants to, and how he wants to. He's going to come through not on our time frame, but he's going to come through according to his set time. He will not be rushed. He will not be delayed. He will not be hindered. He will not be stopped, but will do what he promised at the appointed set time. The Bible tells us in Galatians 4 and verse 5, but when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. God does everything according to his set timing. He did not send Jesus to this earth until his set time. He did not send him early. He did not send him late. He sent him according to the time that he had set and ordained in heaven. God does everything according to his set time. In John chapter 7, verse 4 through 6, some of the men tried to convince Jesus to go up to Judea and show off his power. They said in John 7 verse 4, they said, for there's no man that doeth anything in secret, and he himself seeketh to be known openly. If thou do these things, show thyself to the world. Then Jesus said, verse 6, then Jesus said to them, my time is not yet come, but your time is always ready. Jesus is sending a message that God does everything according to his set time. They wanted Jesus to go up and perform some miracles and dazzle the people, but that was not Jesus' purpose. They wanted Jesus to go and show off. And Jesus said, it ain't my time yet. Why? Because God does everything according to his set time. And Jesus understood this, that even though Jesus had the power to dazzle the people, even though Jesus had the power to just blow their mind, Jesus was not going to show off. He simply told the people that God has set a time for me. He has a set time. I want you to understand that Jesus is sending that message that God does everything according to his set time. Somebody said, God is never late, tardy. He's not. All goes by his plan in the time that he allots. God is never slow. His timing is perfected. The hour, the minute, the second, he has already selected. God is never delayed. His purpose is on track. on his own timetable. Not a second will he tack. God is never late. He knows how long the span. All will work out in the end, for time is in his hand. So hold on to God and know that he will come through according to his set time. Your victory will come according to the appointed set time. Somebody's praying for healing. Your healing will come at the appointed set time that God has set up. Your joy will come at the appointed set time. Your employment will come at the appointed set time. Someone is praying for a financial blessing. Your financial blessing will come at the appointed set time. Your promotion will come at the appointed set time. Your exaltation will come at the appointed set time. Your deliverance will come at the appointed set time. Somebody's praying for a spouse. Your spouse will come at the appointed set time. Your night will be turned into day at the appointed set time. Your enemies will become your footstool at the appointed set time. You will become the head and not the tail, the front and not the back, the first and not the last. At God's appointed set time, whatever has gone wrong in your life, he will make it right according to his appointed set time. So in the meantime and in between time, you got to press through unanswered prayers. You got to believe that God still cares. You got to know he's working things out. You got to stand firm in faith and not doubt. You got to press on through the ups and the downs. You got to keep trusting till his answer resounds. You got to understand it's all about his timing. You got to hold on tight while the answer he is priming. You got to believe and trust. You got to press on through while God is preparing the right answer for you. For the Bible says in Romans 8:28, and we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. But it's not going to happen except it happens according to his set time.
It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen except according to God's set time. If you continue to read in the book of Exodus, you will note that God delivered Israel from the Egyptian bondage. You will note that when God sent the angel, the death angel, through and killed all the firstborn of Egypt, that they literally thrust the Israelites out of their country. You will note that God worked it out, because God will not be denied, and God worked it out according to his set time. So be encouraged, brothers and sisters. If you're struggling, hang on in there. God has heard your prayer and he is in the process of working it out, but he's gonna only work it out according to his set time. You only do it according to his set time, because God works according to his set time.
Our featured story today is how Joshua fought the Battle of Jericho. How Joshua took down the walls of Jericho by blowing the sheep horns, and how the walls came tumbling down. You'll understand it better once you see the story.
40 years have we wandered the wilderness. Those sufferings are now past. For today, as the Lord hath promised, we shall finally cross over the River Jordan and enter the promised land. You priests, men of Levi, will lead us. You will take up the Ark of the Covenant and pass on ahead of our people.
Loaded down like that, they can't possibly make it across the river.
The Israelites have been sighted on the far shore. They're marching this way. Good. They've picked the worst possible time. The floodwaters will seize them, and we can easily finish off any who have the bad luck not to drown. Look! There they are! Only four men, and not even soldiers? What is that box? What is it they carry?
Move out bravely! Then stop when you reach midstream.
Midstream? With a load like that, they'll never make it.
The water level's going down.
The river's dropping! They're not even getting wet! It's just a freak current. You'll see, the waters will rise again any minute and sweep them away.
My men stand ready.
Have them cross the minute the riverbed is completely dry.
It's just like the Red Sea parting for Moses.
Captain! The river, it's gone!
Did you hear? The Israelites crossed the river. They're on their way here.
They can cross all the rivers they want. They'll never get past these walls.
Come on, you, back to work!
This is truly a promised land. Look at it. So green and fertile. Our families will grow strong and healthy here.
How much further is Jericho?
Just past those hills, about 3 miles.
Then your soldiers should get there in no time at all.
And we can grow grain and raise cattle.
Simeon, what about Jericho?
Well, the fact is, we've been ordered not to continue.
You're not going to Jericho?
Joshua has just decreed that first the priests need time to perform their rituals.
Rituals?
After which we shall celebrate Passover, so unleavened cakes must be prepared. We should be ready to march in 3 or 4 days.
3 or 4 days?
Why do they not come? They crossed the river 3 days ago. Well, Captain,
one of our spies has just returned from the Israelite camp.
Yes, yes, and from what direction will they attack?
Sire, they are not marching. He says they have stopped for a special ritual they call Passover.
And what sort of ritual is that?
Well, they eat unleavened cakes.
What manner of warriors do they be? They cause the mighty River Jordan to cease, and then they stop to eat cakes.
My army stands ready. We have reached the promised land. What? Are you one of our soldiers, or are you an enemy of Israel?
Neither, for I am here as captain of the angels of the Lord.
Speak. I am your servant. What do you want me to do?
We have received our orders. This morning we march against Jericho. Take up the Ark of the Covenant and have 7 priests carry trumpets in front of it. Then march around the city with the armed guard going ahead. And I command all of you, during the entire march, do not give a war cry. Do not raise your voices. Do not say a word. After circling the city once, we shall return to camp.
Did he say we just returned to camp? And that's all?
So, at last they come.
And my men are ready.
Why are they so quiet? And what do they carry on those poles?
I don't know. It's what they carried before them when the river stopped.
Sorcery? Magic? Well, whatever it is, it cannot come through solid walls. only that roadway were in range of our spears.
Sire, look! They're going back to their camp!
A retreat? Before joining action?
Well, perhaps the strength of our walls discouraged them.
They never made a sound. Not a war cry, nothing. Just blew on those accursed trumpets.
A parade? That's all it was. A musical parade.
We are making war, Simeon. We are sowing uncertainty. We are warring on their minds.
So, we wage war on their minds. And meanwhile, I am rapidly losing my own.
What are they doing now?
Marching.
Marching.
They circled the city once, and again they start back to their camp. Sire, a suggestion. Our spies made this map of the Israelite camp. We can attack them.
But that might be what they're trying to trick us into doing, leaving the safety of our walls.
But they may be thinking we wouldn't attack.
Then again, they may be thinking we'd be thinking. That's what they would be thinking, that we wouldn't think we... What are they up to? What? Oh!
We shall continue as commanded, Simeon. Learn to trust and use man's greatest strength. And it is not sinew of arm. It is faith in the Lord.
But, sir...
Be patient. Other battles may call for your valor and steel. But Jericho shall be conquered without it. Today we shall encircle the city seven times. Then upon my command, shout aloud. Shout with all your being. Shout for the glory of the Lord. For he hath said, he will give you the city.
Why can't they at least play a different tune? How many days have they been doing this now? 20? 30?
But this is the seventh day.
Well, it seems like they've been at it forever. And every day, the same old...
There's something different today. They're marching around a second time. They've never done that. It may mean an attack.
Alert the men, and tell the spearmen to aim at those hornblowers first.
They've stopped.
Get your men ready for an attack.
Once again, this is your friend Chloe. May God bless you and have a great week.
Well, friends, we've come to the end of another broadcast. We trust and pray that you enjoyed today's message, and we want to take this opportunity to invite you back to join us again on next week for another look at the Word of God. Until next time, be blessed, not stressed. Don't you dare get involved in, be a part of, or take any of the devil's mess.